Hi, my name is Abhi, and I lead the NLP team at formerly MosaicML, now part of Databricks. In this module, I'll be talking about training LLMs from scratch and some of the infrastructure and science that goes into that, with a focus on how we built the open source models MPT, 7B, and 30B. So in this talk, there'll be three main sections. The first is compute and orchestration, basically how we execute these large LLM training runs on big clusters of GPUs. I'll be talking about the training runtime, some of the software and open source libraries that we've developed that make it easy and high performance for our customers. And lastly, I'll be talking about the MPT models themselves, some of the choices that our research team made in terms of the data, architectures that we used, how we fine-tuned these models to produce different variants, and also how we evaluated them. So let's get started. The first section is about compute and orchestration. The most important thing to know about training LLMs is that they require a lot of compute. And when I say compute, I mean the actual math and floating point operations required to actually train them. To actually finish all this math in a human-friendly time scale, aka weeks, not years, we have to parallelize the work across hundreds to thousands of GPUs. And that's what's unique about this. We need special tools for launching these very large runs on huge clusters of GPUs, for managing the compute and sharing with your teammates, for automatically resuming the runs in cases of failure, and all sorts of things like that. So at MosaicML, we basically decided to build a product that specifically addresses for ML engineers, and we called it the MosaicML Cloud. It's an orchestration and scheduling layer that sits on top of any GPU compute cluster. Whether it's yours, you know, whether you rent compute from us, you can submit jobs seamlessly to any one of them. And what's special about it is that it basically addresses all of these different problems that ML engineers face when they're actually trying to train models at scale. So that means multi-node training, that means resuming runs when they fail, it means supporting object stores both for dataset streaming and for checkpointing, and also experiment trackers such as ML flow and weights and biases. And the best part, of course, is that it's high performance and that we tune it for all the different cloud providers out there. So when you come to us, you don't have to redo all of that work. So what does this actually look like in practice? Here you can see a multi-node training job submission via the MosaicML Cloud. And on the left side, you can see the actual YAML file that a user submits. And there's a couple of key pieces. One is like a Docker image. Then there's an integration for checking out a GitHub repo, and that's your source code. And then it's really just a series of commands, the training run commands. The sort of magical part about this is that you can submit this to any one of the clusters like in your account. And you can also seamlessly scale the number of GPUs, whether it's 1 or 8 or 256, and it really all just works. So multi-node orchestration makes it easy to launch these runs on very big clusters, but what about the performance? So something that we found in the course of MosaicML is that a lot of the compute clusters being built in the clouds actually have really good internode networking. What that means is that the bandwidth between GPUs across different machines is actually relatively high. And what that means is that with the right software and the right orchestration tools, you can actually launch jobs on large clusters with near linear scaling. That means that your job gets done, you know, 14 or 15x faster. In this picture, we got a 14.4x speedup out of a 16x number of GPUs. And that basically means you can get your job done faster without paying much more in total cost. After all, if you train a job that's 10x bigger but only use 1/10 the time, then the actual cost ends up being about the same. So early on in MosaicML, we focus on multi-node scaling as a way to deliver models faster to our customers without necessarily increasing the price they had to pay. So scaling out is maybe the most exciting part of LLM training, but there's also a lot of details when it comes to doing the science. One of those is determinism, and we focused on determinism early in many components of our stack so that we could do science accurately. Basically, anytime you want to try a new method or try a different architecture, you want to make sure the run you're doing doesn't have a lot of noise in it or that the eval metrics you measure don't either. So on the left side, you can see one of the technologies we built, streaming dataset, where basically we enable streaming data from object store to large clusters of GPUs. And whether you use one GPU or two or 64, the actual loss curve you get is pretty much deterministic. The order of the samples is deterministic. You can kind of see what it looks like when you don't have this feature on the top, and you get, you know, a sort of a curve that looks approximately the same, but not exactly. And on the bottom, you get pretty much totally deterministic results. This also means that you can actually resume runs on different number of GPUs. So if your cluster has a failure, or you need to share some compute with your teammate, you can actually stop and resume your job on a different number of GPUs, and you'll still continue exactly as it did before. Now on the right side, there we have a similar situation when it comes to our trainer, so our actual like trainer loop that trains the model on each GPU. One of the challenges there is that we use microbatching as a technique to avoid out-of-memory errors. So that means when we have a total batch of data to process, we actually split into smaller microbatches first and do a forwards and backwards pass on each one of them, and then we accumulate the gradient across them all. So once again, to make sure that our training runs are agnostics to sort of the memory capacity you have and the microbatch size you choose, we basically made sure that our microbatching engine is deterministic. So you can see that whether we use a microbatch size of 1 or 2 all the way up to 7, we get nearly the exact same loss curve with the numerics. Now, the last part of the orchestration stack that I like to talk about is resumption. And this is actually a challenge that many people don't know about until you actually start to train LLMs at scale, which is that these GPU clusters have very common hardware failures. These hardware failures can range from networking errors to actual hardware failures where you have to remove the whole machine. And the issue is that they occur quite frequently, once every 1,000 A100 days or so. So in this run, for instance, I think we were training on 512 A100s, and we basically had a failure almost once every 2 days. This was the MPT7B run. So traditionally, researchers would have to babysit training runs like this and basically wait for something to go wrong, and then maybe at 2 a.m. or something, you'd have to wake up and stop the run and resume it. With our platform, we aim to basically eliminate this. So our orchestration tool actually detects these failures on its own and will seamlessly stop the run, detect any hardware failures, cordon those machines that are broken, and then resume the run automatically. So for MPT7B, we actually were able to get the entire training run done with no human intervention whatsoever, thanks to our orchestration tools. The next part I'd like to talk about is the training runtime. So this is the actual software libraries, many of which we've open sourced, that make it easy to train LLMs efficiently. Now the first component I'd like to talk about is actually not related to the models, but to the data. Now from the very beginning, we've been focused on helping customers train their own private models and their own private data. But to do that in a way that's secure, we needed to be able to stream their data from object stores to the compute cluster. And we built an open source library called MosaicML Streaming to do that. Now, what this enables you to do is you can use any objects from providers such as S3 or GCS or OCI or R2, and you basically stream your data to the compute cluster in a way that doesn't require you to wait for the whole data to download. It has very high performance and good shuffling. And crucially, as soon as the run is done, the data is deleted, so it's only used ephemerally for the purpose of the training run. We never store it on the compute cluster at all. Now, another benefit of this is that it basically lets you separate where you're doing your computing from where your data is stored. So you can stream data from AWS to a compute cluster in Oracle Cloud, and we actually do this a lot internally in MosaicML. And it basically means you have a lot of negotiating power over your compute provider. Now, the next component I talk about is our open source training library called Composer. Now, Composer is a library built on top of PyTorch that makes it easy to train models from diffusion models to LLM models to image models. And it takes care of all of the details such as mixed precision training, distributed training, object store checkpointing, and all those kinds of things that enable you to train these models at scale in the cloud. Now, it also comes with a really neat callback system so you can customize it to your needs. You can write algorithms that occur at different stages of the training loop, such as after the forwards pass or before the optimizer step, and you can register these and basically tailor it for whatever you need for your runs. So internally at MosaicML, we use Composer for all of our training runs, and it just makes things really nice, and it works with diffusion and LLMs. Now, specific to large language models, a technique I like to talk about is fully sharded data parallelism. And what this is, it's basically a way of splitting the parameters of the model across all the GPUs in your cluster so that you don't run out of memory. Some of the largest models we train have, 30 billion parameters or more, and so they would never actually fit on a single GPU at training time. Instead, we use FSDP, built by the PyTorch team, to actually split these parameters across the cluster, and then only as they're needed in the forwards pass are they gathered from across the cluster. One benefit of this is that it's very flexible to the model architecture. We can train any Hugging Face style LLM, our MPT architecture. We've used this to train stable diffusion architectures, and it basically means we don't have to worry about tensor parallelism or pipeline parallelism. We just use this one FSDP strategy across all of our model types. So here's a diagram of what that actually looks like. You can see during the forwards pass, we gather the weights from the cluster to each GPU to do just that single forwards pass for the layer, and then we discard the weights for the layer. Then we repeat that again for layer 2 and layer 3 and so on all the way up to the end of the network. On the backwards pass is the same thing in reverse. As we need layer n at the end, we all gather the weights and perform the backwards pass and again discard it. The gradients and optimizer state are similarly sharded so that the entire model state used during training is now split across the cluster. What this really means is that now your total number of parameters only has to fit in the cluster memory, not each GPU memory. That's what makes it different from DDP, distributed data parallelism. The last bit I'd like to mention is that all these pieces are useful on their own, but putting it all together into a single platform for LLMs is something we focused on in the earlier half of this year. And we have an open source library called LLM Foundry. This is basically a complete toolkit for, you know, preparing your pre-trained data, for actually doing those training runs, for fine-tuning the models afterwards, for evaluating them on custom eval datasets, and even preparing your models for inference. The sort of magic part about the system we built is that everything that our research team uses is all externalized. So MPT 7B and 30B were all built with the LLM Foundry, and that way our customers and our community members can use the same exact tools to build their LLMs. Now, the last section I'd like to talk about is the MPT models themselves, starting with the data. So when we set out to train MPT 7B and 30B, we picked a token budget of approximately 1 trillion tokens, and then we basically filled that in with lots of different data sources across the web. You can see we use different sources of English web data, you know, common crawl scrapes. We have code data coming from the stack, as well as GitHub. We have scientific papers from Archive and Stack Exchange, and lots of things like this. Now, one thing that occurs when you're dealing with these very, very large data sets is that you have to clean them. Basically, filtering and deduplicating these data sets is crucial, especially if you have multiple overlapping web scrapes. Picking the proportions is also important too. When we pre-train these models, we generally have a sort of general use case that we're targeting. We expect these base models to be fine-tuned by different customers for different like tasks. But we still have some choices to make, such as how much English data put in versus how much code data. And using some of our libraries like streaming dataset, it's easy to choose these proportions at runtime. And we basically perform small pre-training run experiments to see how that affects downstream performance. For MPT in particular, we chose to actually upweight the amount of code. And as a result, the MPT models are particularly good at coding compared to some similarly sized models that are open sourced. We also find that the tokenizer can have a lot of impact. So on particular fields like math, arithmetic, coding, where you know the spaces and tabs are very important, and foreign languages, having a tokenizer that's built for those situations will greatly improve performance. Now, when it comes to the model architecture, for the MPT series, we chose to keep things pretty conservative. We basically started with the same architecture and model as the GPT-3 series, which is a decoder-only transformer. The main improvements we made were on the performance using flash attention, which is basically a much more optimized kernel for performing the attention operation that is math equivalent but increases the speed and reduces the amount of memory used. The other big change we made was that we removed the positional embeddings, which traditionally put a hard limit on the amount of tokens you can have in a sequence. And we used a relative positional embedding called Alibi instead. Now, what Alibi enables us to do is actually have a bias that's added to the attention mask. And that way, at runtime, if we wanted to, we could stretch this bias tensor out to a longer sequence length. And it also makes it very easy to fine-tune a base model to have a longer context length if you wish. And as I'll talk about later, we did this for MPT-7B for one of our models called StoryWriter. Now, how do we actually make these decisions as a research team? Well, it all comes down to scaling laws at small test runs. Effectively, we test out many different architecture choices with small models, such as 100 million models up to 1 billion parameters. And we like to plot kind of the quality we get versus the amount of compute used. And we can basically draw a scaling trend from this. Based on that trend, we can see if an architecture kind of improves the performance at every scale. And that's what we would see as like a sort of a Pareto improvement. And then that would give us the confidence to actually scale that architecture up to the final sizes, like 7 billion and 30 billion parameters. We find these scaling laws are very, very helpful for retraining. Now, what about fine-tuning? So with each MPT model we built, 7B and 30B, we also built a couple different fine-tuned variants. These basically take the base model, which has been pre-trained for a very, very long time, and then continue the training on a small curated data set, where that curated data set either has a particular input-output style, where it has a prefix that kind of aligns it better to what you want. And we have two variants that we focus on for 30B and 7B, the instruction following variant, which helps with short form tasks like converting instructions to JSON, or picking the best item out of a list. And then we have a multi-turn chat fine-tuned model, which is basically for the chat use case like ChatGPT. For MPT 7B, we also targeted a unique situation, which is StoryWriter, where we took our base model and fine-tuned it on a lot of books with very, very long context length. And as I mentioned before, our architecture choice to use Alibi made it very easy to do that. And as a result, we were able to build a model that could ingest entire books like The Great Gatsby and then continue writing like the next chapter or an epilogue. Most of these are demonstrations, but it kind of shows the art of what's possible for our customers. So if they have particular tasks that need that long context, we can help them build those models. Now, it's important to know that fine-tuned runs are a lot faster and cheaper than pre-training. So much so that some of those scaling trends I talked about before are less relevant here. In the fine-tuning space, we can actually just try out all the ideas at the full token budget and basically pick the one that's best. We also found that larger models, such as 30B over 7B, are easier to fine-tune and may actually require fewer samples to do so. So following up on that point, here are some of the actual training details for MPT 7B and the fine-tuned models. You can see that the base model costs approximately $200,000 to train, but the fine-tuned models are much cheaper. So the instruct model costs only $37, the chat model a few hundred dollars, and StoryWriter a few thousand dollars. So in general, having strong foundation-based models for customers makes it easier and more cost-effective for them to build custom fine-tuned models for themselves. Now, the last part I'd like to talk about is evaluation. So evaluation is very much an open problem, and as you'll hear about in other modules, there's no one way to do it. We're constantly evolving our techniques and getting better at it over time. In the past, evaluating MPT against other models in our first 7B blog post, we basically looked at the zero-shot and few-shot performance of our models on individual tasks, academic tasks that have been collected in previous papers, such as the GPT-3 paper, and basically seeing how we stacked up to the competition that way. Since our base models are used by people for a large, large variety of tasks, though, we found that this system is a little ineffective. Instead, we now actually aggregate performance across a very large number of tasks, and you can see on the bottom our new model gauntlet technique. So here, across six different dimensions, such as programming or world knowledge, we actually have 20 to 30 or 50 tasks within that, across which we average the performance. And then we can actually see, sort of in this radar chart, how each model generation improves upon the last. We can see that MPT 30B, for instance, outperforms 7B in every single dimension. Now, in the future, we think that model evaluation will go even farther than this. We've been exploring techniques where we actually submit the same prompt to two or three different models and ask a human to actually rank which one they prefer over the other. And this can help us develop sort of heads-up competitions or ELO ratings across models. The main takeaway is that LLMs, as they get more powerful, as they start to saturate our simple benchmarks, we have to come up with more complicated ones and more human-involved ELO metrics. So to recap, building models like MPT takes a lot of infrastructure and science. At MosaicML and Databricks, we're working to help bring that into the hands of more customers so that they don't have to worry about all the challenging infrastructure and multi-node training details. They can just bring their data and focus on building a model that's right for them. Thank you for your time.